What's up, guys? My name's Brandon, and after the craziness that happened last week, this week was bound to be a lot less exciting when it comes to Apple software updates. But we did get one update, and that was watchOS 8.4.1, which dropped on Tuesday, and I did make a video on that here on the channel. If you want to check it out, it will be linked down in the description below. But aside from that, we've been discovering even more new features and changes in iOS 15.4 beta 1, and this update is insane. It's a lot bigger than expected. It's probably the biggest update to iOS 15 since the initial version. I mean, there's just so much that's changed in this update. It really makes up for all the lost time with iOS 15.3. We were in beta and iOS 15.3 forever for really no major changes. But anyways, we're going to talk about even more new features and changes in iOS 15.4 beta 1. We're going to talk about the performance, the battery life. We're going to cover some of the latest Apple leaks and rumors and much more. All right, so let's start off with some more iOS 15.4 features and changes. And the first thing is actually inside of Apple Music. And when you go into a playlist, let's just go into my tunes playlist right here, and you start scrolling down, you will notice that the name of the playlist is now sticky and it sticks to the top menu bar right there as you scroll down. So this is a very small touch, but it's actually pretty useful because sometimes when I'm deep in my playlist, I forget which playlist it is. So it's nice to have that up right there, especially if you're browsing random playlists. You could always see that when you're scrolling down, which is nice. Now also, if you haptic press on the music icon on the home screen, we have a couple of new options here as well. Number one is Play My Station. That's new. And then also Play Most Recent is right there as an option as well. Both of those are new in 15.4 beta 1. Now we also have a new screen for Apple Pay before you unlock your phone. So if I go ahead and activate Apple Pay right here, you could see that this is a new page. It's slightly different. I'm gonna move it away from my face. You can see this white screen right here has a new UI compared to iOS 15.3. So let me go ahead and bring over my 15.3 device right here. You guys can see, of course, that is what it looked like previously, and it showed kind of everything. It doesn't show all of your cards in here anymore. So it just has a whole new UI when you go to Apple Pay on 15.4. We also have a nice change when it comes to Keychain. When you save your passwords, like in Safari, if you enter any password, you can save it to your iCloud Keychain. Well, Keychain will now prompt you to enter a username when saving a password without one. So if you save a password and your username's not there, it will prompt you to enter that username. So shout out to a Reddit user for bringing this to my attention. We also have a minor change inside of the Stocks application. So now when you go to the Stories on the front page, you can see we have more of like a widget style of UI right here. So just a slight difference between 15.3 on the left, 15.4 on the right. Everything is the same once you go into the article, but it's different on this main screen right here. Another very interesting feature that's coming in iOS 15.4 is push notifications for web-based applications. So third-party applications and web-based applications will now be able to send you push notifications natively. So this was found in the code, and you know, nobody's using it yet, but it looks like in the code it was found that soon push notifications are going to be enabled for web-based applications, which is going to be really awesome for a lot of people. Also, one of the big features that I mentioned that I feel like is going underlooked right now is inside of shortcuts automations. And when you go to one of your automations, you can see there's a little bit of lag right there, and that's what I'll talk about later in this video as well. But when you go into here, we have the notify when run option right there, which will essentially disable your shortcut notifications, which is something we've been trying to do forever. Of course, this doesn't disable them permanently, but now you will not get a notification when the automation is run, which is something that has always annoyed me, and it's worked really well over the past week. I've used this. Obviously, I change my wallpaper every single day, every single time at sunrise. I would always wake up with a notification from shortcuts, but now I don't, and it's nice. I've also really been loving the wallet widget. Obviously, I don't like how much money I spend sometimes, but it does update in real time, which is nice. So it'll help me monitor and kind of track my expenses as well, just at a glance without having to go into the wallet application. And then I also wanted to talk about universal control. So I didn't show this in my initial video, but if you go to your iPadOS 15.4 settings and then go to your settings, general, AirPlay, and handoff, you will see we have a new toggle there for cursor and keyboard, and it says it's in beta, and it says allow your cursor and keyboard to be used on any nearby Mac signed into your iCloud account. So that is a toggle you need to make sure is enabled before trying out universal control. But my experience over the past week, I've used it every single day, is amazing, especially for a first beta. Of course, it has been delayed several times, so it's expected to be good even in the first beta, but it is awesome. I honestly, at this point, cannot live without it. So I really hope it improves. And I've only had a few bugs, but it's worked pretty amazing so far. Now, as far as the bugs go in iOS 15.4 beta 1, I have had issues with apps crashing. I talked about this in last week's video. I talked about ESPN crashing, and as you can see, it still crashes upon launch, even after an app update. So, you know, that's an issue. I've also had issues with Reddit crashing. It works fine just now, but it does randomly crash sometimes. So random app crashes, but that's pretty much it. I mean, I have the occasional lag. I do have issues with shortcuts as well. Shortcuts is a lot laggier than it was on 15.3 when it comes to switching between menus. It's faster when I go into a shortcut and edit things around, but when I switch to these menus, sometimes it really hangs, like we saw earlier in this video. Also inside of my settings, if I go down to general and then to background app refresh and then all the way down, you'll see that we have a weird icon right there, no icon for the web toggle. So that's a minor bug here. Of course, things you see and betas. And then also some people are having cell connectivity issues where their cell connectivity just kind of switches back and forth between 5G and LTE continuously. It just flashes back and forth between those two and it can't make up its mind. So it only fixes itself after a reboot, but that is an issue with cellular. And then also last week I did mention issues with Face ID just simply not working sometimes. Well, I have not had that experience since then. So that seems to be not super common what I experience. So Face ID has actually worked really well over the past week. I've used it multiple times to pay for things, just using it. And of course, I don't have glasses, so I haven't tested out how accurate it is with a mask and glasses. But if you have, let me know in a comment down below how that's working out. But so far, this seems like a really, really solid feature, even in the first beta. So it's only going to get better with time, and I'm excited for that. Now, as far as the performance goes, it's still running pretty well. Not much has really changed since last week's follow-up video, aside from a few more minor issues like Apple Music crashing and some other UI bugs, just minor things like that. There's still some minor lag when multitasking and, you know, again, when I'm in the Shortcuts app and going back and forth between these two tabs. But again, it's a first beta and I'm not too mad at the performance so far, especially when I check out my Geekbench score here. You can see we got a 1740 on the single core and a 4889 on the multi-core. So very strong scores there. Of course, I like to test this later on as well once the phone is kind of re-indexed and cooled down a little bit. So pretty solid scores there on iOS 15.4. And then as far as the battery life goes, you know, last week I had not used the software long enough to really come to a conclusion about how good or bad the battery life is. But now that it's been more than a week of using it, I have a good idea of battery life on beta 1. And while it's not bad, it's definitely not good either. I noticed a drop of about 50 to 55 minutes of on-screen time compared to iOS 15.3. So definitely room for improvement, and I'm sure we will get that with the coming betas, but not too hot on the battery front so far here with beta 1. All right, so now let's talk about what is next for Apple. So next up is iOS 15.4 beta 2. And like I mentioned in last week's video, last weekend's follow-up video, I said that we could see a beta 2 sometime late this week or early next week. And now it's looking like it's gonna be, of course, early next week. So I'm guessing the 7th or the 8th is probably when we'll see iOS 15.4 beta 2. Apple has been liking Tuesdays lately, so I would put my money on February 8th. But of course, Apple is super unpredictable and it could come really at any point next week. And then as for the final version of iOS 15.4, this is coming in the first half of March. So this was confirmed by Bloomberg, and this, you know, aligns with what I said previously, that we could see iOS 15.4 at the Apple event or shortly after. And that's looking like it's going to be the case. Apple will likely talk about iOS 15.4 at their Apple event, which has been rumored to be coming on March 8th. That's when we could expect to see an Apple event. So that could be the day that we see iOS 15.4, the final release, or it could come the next day on the 9th or even the week after. All we know is that it's going to come for sure in the first half of March, which technically gives us until like the 15th or the 16th as the latest possible date. And you guys already know the drill. If you're not following me on Twitter already, make sure you go over and follow me on there. That's where I give you guys updates on everything when it comes to iOS release dates. All right, so now let's move on to some of the latest Apple news. So you guys remember the redesigned 27-inch iMac Pro that we've been talking about for the past few weeks? Well, it looks like that's been delayed from the upcoming spring event to sometime later in the summer. This news comes courtesy of Ross Young, who tweeted out, quote, "We no longer expect the Apple iMac Pro to launch in the spring. Looks more like summer. Still with a mini LED backlight, but fewer mini LEDs slash zones than an iPad and MacBook Pros. We expect panel shipments from June, but the product may not launch until August or September." Now, the iMac might be delayed, but the new iPhone SE, iPad Air, and new Mac Mini are almost definitely coming at this spring event. And the latest source of this news is Mark Gurman. So I made a full video yesterday going through everything to expect at this event, including the date of the event, which is currently set at Tuesday, March 8th. So if you guys want to check out that video and see everything to expect at the event, I will leave that linked up in the cards right now and also down in the description below. But super exciting, our first event of the year, first event really of many to come, with what could be a record-breaking year for Apple in terms of product launches. Now, this next story is very interesting, and it relates to sideloading applications, which is where you basically install an application from a third-party website. So a U.S. Senate committee just recently approved an antitrust bill called the Open App Markets Act, which would allow sideloading on the iPhone. This is something that's been controversial for quite a while now, and just days before this meeting to approve the bill, Apple's head of government affairs, Tim Powderly, sent a letter to committee members urging them to reject the bill, saying, quote, "Sideloading would enable bad actors to evade Apple's privacy and security protections by distributing apps with critical privacy and security checks. These provisions would allow malware, scams, and data exploitation to proliferate." But the bill was approved regardless, and we are now a little closer to sideloading becoming a reality on iOS. Now, we do have to wait and see what happens next on the Senate floor, but this is very, very interesting and has a huge mixed reaction. So what do you guys think? Are you for or against sideloading applications from places outside of Apple's App Store? I'm personally stuck in the middle because I can see how this would cause malware on iOS and iPadOS. I think it will definitely lead to more malware. But at the same time, I also know how fun some of these games and applications are that you can only get from third-party websites because, you know, it's illegal to be in the App Store. Things like the, you know, N64 emulators or the PSP emulators, you know, the Game Boy emulators, things like that. Really fun stuff that we used to be able to do that we basically don't have access to anymore, at least not easily. And that would become a reality again. We'd be able to play all those old games on our iPhone again. But at the same time, again, we do risk all of the malware and other bad things potentially coming to iOS. So let me know what you guys think in the comments below. And then finally, in some very strange and potentially scary news, someone out there is removing the speaker from Apple's AirTags and selling them online. Now, sure, if we lived in a world where people were not crazy, this would be a non-story. But of course, we're not, especially here in America. So when I saw this headline, the first thing I thought of is that some creep is going to go buy these and slip them into unsuspecting victims, you know, belongings, a purse, whatever, and stalk them. And even if they get the alert on their phone that an AirTag is tracking them, when they hit the play sound button to try to get rid of the AirTag, it's just not going to make a noise because there's no speaker installed anymore. So that is, you know, super creepy. But the other side of this argument is so that if somebody stole your item, they would not be able to find the AirTag and throw it out and get rid of it. So you're always going to be able to track said stolen item because the people who stole it are not going to be able to find the AirTag that you hid there. But, you know, let's be honest, most people who are, you know, thinking about buying these or who searched up to buy a modified AirTag are probably not buying them with the best intentions in mind. I mean, I could be wrong, but what do you guys think? Do you think that only creeps are buying these, or do you think people are buying them for a good reason? Now, I'm also curious if you think we're going to see Apple discontinue the AirTag after so much negative press really ever since they were first released. It seems like bad story after bad story after bad story is coming out about the AirTags. There's really not a lot of positive stories out there about them, but it's Apple. People are always going to blame Apple, you know, when Tile's out there, when all these other manufacturers are out there that do the same thing, their trackers do the same thing, you know, even arguably less secure because you don't even get alerts on your phone when you're being tracked. I don't know how those work, but I'm sure they're not as secure and as high tech as Apple's AirTags are, but you don't really see too many negative, you know, stories out there about them. But of course, the AirTags are more popular, so people are going to blame the AirTag and not just, you know, every other tracker on the market. But I don't know. What do you guys think about this? Do you think Apple's going to have to discontinue the AirTags? Do you think this is just going to blow over? What do you think about this? And also, do you think they're going to have to release a new version so people can't modify these and take the speaker out, at least not as easily? Really curious to see what you guys have to say about this one as well. But anyways, guys, there you have it. That is the latest batch of Apple news from this past week, along with some additional info on the highly anticipated iOS 15.4. If you guys enjoyed this video, as always, I would appreciate if you give it a thumbs up. And of course, make sure to subscribe for a lot more iOS 15.4 coverage. And of course, my weekly iOS videos like this one. And if you guys want my wallpaper, it will be linked down in the description below. But anyways, guys, thanks again for watching, and I'll see you soon.